Hello, everybody. We're back for another session today on this beautiful Saturday, Sabbath day, July 11, 2020. And we are going to start a new series on Queen. But Michael, what is it with this group? There's four men in front of us. Where's the Queen? I don't get it.
Hello, Brett, and hello, dear listeners. Yes, actually, a new series here of another world-famous band called The Queen. But there is no Queen. It's just about the Rolling Stones where there is no Rolling Stone.
So it's a bunch of long-haired guys, you know, like, are they trying to be Queens or...
Talk about the 70s. You see, the haircut is typically 70s, glam rock,
yeah,
something
right.
Like that.
Glam
yes.
Rock.
The most profound member, I think, is Freddie Mercury, wearing here some kind of lipstick.
Oh, eye makeup. You can see that.
Yeah, having some kind of his...
Eyeliner,
yeah.
What do you call that when you put that on your eyelids?
Kind of,
what is that called again?
Some kind of... You're the English-speaking guy here.
I forget. I don't know all the terms. I'm not going to say it because I'll screw it up.
But it's no secret that Freddie Mercury was at least bisexual.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah, you see that. So his outfit is very fitting. You see, he's wearing a kind of a fur coat, something like that. Oh, what is it actually? It's just not a usual shirt he's wearing. So we will come across Freddie Mercury big scale, but you're absolutely right. It's about Queen, and there is no Queen, or is it?
Mm-hmm.
Because you see, of course, that Freddie Mercury is, as I mentioned before, at least bisexual, and many of his close friends are arguing that he was not even bisexual but homosexual. So you see, there is an English catchphrase or abbreviation, I think it's the right word, sorry for being not a native English speaker. So about queer, so if you replace the N at the end of Queen, you got queer, and that's a code word for being a homosexual. But you
that's
see
a
that
very...
it's a very interesting topic now, this, because Queen actually is a, of course, mm-hmm. They would not be in this session, they would not be on the program on Brett Norman's broadcasting channels if they were not satanic. So what's about Queen? What's about Queen here? Yeah, because you see, that's a world famous band. They sold millions and millions of records. But actually, why did they sell millions of records? Because most of the people are in the Antichrist spirit. So the extremely important and successful artists have to write songs and have to make performances on stage for people being in the Antichrist spirit, which is not automatically saying that every guy or girl who is into Queen songs is in the Antichrist spirit. But if you come across the songs and the lifestyle of Freddie Mercury, you will see there is no Christian behavior at all. It will get very strange sometimes. I don't think that Queen is better or worse than Pink Floyd. Maybe it's even worse, but we will have to find out. That is just the first picture here, and welcome to the beginning of the group Queen. Okay, let me proceed. Yeah, you see, oops, this is a strange foreign language. This is German. So, which means that you are not now welcome to look up your own Wikipedia page, which tells you all about Queen, how many records they have sold, about 200 millions. And how successful they were, and how many albums they have produced, and how many songs were number one in several countries, which are not important issues for us, because we would like to get into the nitty-gritty. We would like to get behind the veil, beyond anything, because you see, that's it, just another band with 200 million sold records. You see that you were one of the commercial successful bands. And the most successful unit, which Wikipedia is you're referring to, is Another One Bites the Dust. Oh, well, is it a positive or a negative content when Another One Bites the Dust? You see? Mm-hmm. As I told you. Okay. Mm-hmm. So, I ran across a German dictionary, or what is it in English? Webster's? If you look something up, which is the correct name? It's not lexicon, Webster's. Help me out, Brett, please.
Oh, yeah. Let's see.
Webster's.
Oh, the dictionary? Oh, you mean the... hello, this morning. I'm trying to wake up, and I'm not quite awake yet. Webster's? No, not Webster's, you said. What do you need help with, Michael?
Yeah, it's a lexicon where you can look things up. It's a dictionary.
Oh, etymology?
Yes, it's a dictionary. This is a child dictionary here. What is being told
kinder,
to Charles?
Yes, children.
What is being
yes.
told to Charles what Queen is about? And they were telling that, Queen is just a musical band from Great Britain. And they have been founded in 1970 and was named after the British Queen, Elizabeth. Yeah? Okay, that's about it. That's about it at all. Yeah? So, Queen. And this is, of course, Ezekiel 28:13 about the first musician. So, if they are really successful, they have to praise Lucifer. And we will find out if they do. Because you see that if we know that they have their name according to the Royal Highness of the United Kingdom, speaking of a kingdom, is United Kingdom is a kingdom. It's not a republic. It's an official kingdom. And the Queen is the head of the state. So we're speaking about a kingdom, a United Kingdom. This is the coat of arms of the United Kingdom. It's really big on the big screen here. You see a unicorn, you see a lion, you see crowns. Yeah, you see a harp. Oh, well. And you see, remember, not the 5th of November, but remember, this is the United Kingdom. It's a Britannic and combined with Scotland, Wales, and Northern Ireland. And, they are using what? They are not using an English language here on their coat of arms. Huh? Interesting, isn't it?
Sure.
And also, the unicorn has been chained here because it has been said, so rumor has it, that unicorns are very aggressive and very dangerous animals. As you might expect it, it's all about tradition and it's all about mysticism. It's all about wrong religion, because in the Bible there are also unicorns, but there are no horses with one horn, because unicorn actually, it's like a bull. And I think that you will get aware of the fact that everything which is in the Bible will be turned around 180 degrees if you are having that same story in the heathen way. So they are making fun of the fact that everybody thinks that the unicorn is a magic animal. But unicorns, especially horses with one horn, do not exist. Or haven't you seen anyone lately? As far as I know, I haven't seen anything. So why are they depicting in the coat of arms of the United Kingdom an animal which is supposed to be a magic animal? So it would fit in Walt Disneyland, but not in the United Kingdom. So you see that here, United Kingdom cannot be a Christian country at all because they are using pagan symbols. But that's just the beginning of Queen. There's more to come. Yeah? This here on the outer means Hon ni so ki mal y pense. That's French.
Oh, interesting.
I always thought that French was the arch enemy of England.
Yeah.
And it the meaning in English is about be ashamed who thinks bad about it. Yeah, but it's in French. You see that. Very strange. Very strange. Very strange. Yeah.
And then so, do et mon treut. What's that? At the bottom here.
See yeah. De et mon droit. De. You see, we will get droit. Into that. Oh. Yeah. De et mon droit means God and my right. Having the right to something. Yeah.
Okay.
God
oh, and, okay. That was at the
or
end.
Or God
here.
And I my see. Law. Yeah. Mm. Something like that. Now the Dieu means God. Yeah,
gotcha.
That's French. You see, that's French. It's about the English King, United Kingdom, but with a French inscription here. Great, huh?
Right.
and with the unicorn. Don't forget that. Yeah, and don't forget also, please, that it's not about the United Kingdom alone. You in the United States of America might think that oh, it's just a small country, the United Kingdom of England. No. Because the Queen is the head of state for 53 countries, except officially America or United States.
Yes.
America. But it's the head of state. The Queen is the head of state, for example, Canada, for example, Australia, for example, South Africa, and for example, New Zealand. So if you think about emigrating from the United Kingdom to New Zealand, you could stay as well in England. Okay, the weather is better, maybe, and you get more strange animals. But you see that part of that,
mm-hmm.
yeah. So the lion and the unicorn are the symbolic. Yeah, this is here. Actually, this is no picture, but this is a real sign. Yeah, and you see here the French insignia, and yeah, God and my right, or God and my law. So much for that. And you might know that also this is the coat of arms from the Windsors, which are the ruling family, the monarch family in the United Kingdom. Speaking of Prince Charles, for example, or Prince Andrew. And they have their ancestors in Germany. Yeah, from Saxe-Gotha. In 1917, they changed their name from Saxe-Coburg-Gotha to Windsor due to the anti-German sentiment. Because, you see, 1917 was in the height of the First World War. And England and Germany were supposed to be enemies. So, it's just about 100 years ago that the Germans, who were sitting on the throne of England, changed their name to Windsor. So much for, it's strange that they have a French insignia. Well, it gets more strangely because, you see, these are no English ancestors on the throne. It's coming from Saxe-Coburg-Gotha, which is in East Germany. So actually, there are East German people are the ancestors of the Windsor House. Of course, they speak very well English, of course, no problem. But one of the former ancestors of Queen Elizabeth couldn't speak English, so they spoke German in English with the French insignia, of course. So that's about it. And now we get into Queen. We know that it's the Queen logo. It's
weird.
Queen. Yeah.
And looks like a phoenix on the top there, doesn't it?
Yeah, and now the case is closed. We need no more sessions because Brett is... Yes, made the point.
I mean, it's obvious. I mean, it's like...
It's obvious. What? Of course, it's obvious. But it's just also obvious that they are blatantly lying because you see that...
They're using the same...
Rumor has it. That's my phrase here for the Queen sessions. Rumor has it that the logo of Queen actually depicts the zodiac signs of all the four members of the band. Yeah? You got two lions, lion number one, lion number two, and you got Virgin, yeah, and somewhere also is the, what is it, Cancer? Is it called Cancer in English? I really don't know.
Maybe. Yeah, that's right. I think that's right.
Yeah, so Cancer, huh? So
Cancer. Oh,
yeah, but you see, no one is telling or citing or recognizing or what else the animal on top. And if you are on top, if you are the queen, because it must be the queen, because you see the crown inside the queue. So it must be something about the queen, something about royalty. And above that, above the crown, which is elevated above that, is this kind of strange animal. And this is not a zodiac sign. So it has to be something else. Oh, maybe they got a fifth member, who we don't know already. Yeah, and this is, of course, wrong. It's not about the four zodiac signs, because there is a crown and there is some kind of strange animal. So don't get that BS out of here. Yeah. Okay, so the Queen Crest was designed by Freddie Mercury shortly before the release of their first album. Yeah. You see, goldenrod, sienna, animal, crab, crown, lion, phoenix, everything is in the logo. Two lions for Leo, Mr. Deacon and Mr. Taylor, which is the drummer. A crab for Cancer, which is Mr. May. And two fairies for Virgil, where Freddie Mercury is born in the time when the zodiac sign Virgo has been, or the sun has been in the zodiac sign of Virgo. But we're not going into astrology here because it's coming from Babylon. So, and the entire logo, this is German here, is being covered by a huge giant phoenix. The symbol has a similarity with the royal coat of arms of the United Kingdom. Something like that. Yeah, you see, this is the phoenix. This is Brian May. This is John Deacon and this is Roger Taylor. And Virgil here is Freddie Mac. Huh? This is the official explanation. Yeah, but where's the fifth member? Yeah, you see, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. Why do they display this huge giant phoenix? Any guess? I think you see it's very prominent. It's far larger than both lions together. What's that for a strange animal? The animal comes from Egypt, Bennu, or Greek phoenix, the reborn sun, a mythical animal. Yeah, it's the reincarnated phoenix. You know that phoenix from the ashes, huh? You know that phoenix from the ashes.
Yeah, this is a tough one for us over here in America because we don't know a whole lot about the phoenix.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, but you know the town Phoenix from Arizona.
All I know is when I produced this video that was done from some of the work that Alan Lamont took from. Alan Lamont took this work from author of Vatican Assassins, Eric John Phelps. And Eric John Phelps called the double-headed eagle an eagle instead of a phoenix. And people in Great Britain were all uppity about, oh, that's a phoenix. Mm-hmm. Well, yeah, it's a phoenix. Okay. But it's an eagle too. We get both. Mm-hmm. Which one you like?
A bird is an animal which most of the times is in the air. So it has also spiritual meaning.
Right.
Yeah, it's not a bull. Yeah, a bull cannot fly. At least not far enough.
But I just want to finish this out a little bit, Michael. You know, that they've put burdens on us, grievous to be born, and laid them on men's shoulders. But they themselves will not lift them with one of their fingers, as it says in Matthew 23, when Jesus rebuked the scribes and the Pharisees that sit in Moses' seat. Now, these principles have been put on our backs, just the common lay people, so that we'll fight them against each other to create a synthesis. And what is the result of that synthesis? It's the destruction of our faith. Mm-hmm. And this is globalism. This is the end result of globalism, the society we live in today, this amalgamized so-called culture, this worldwide global so-called culture is no culture at all. It's a synthesis. And I think a lot of people are really upset about it, and rightfully so, I say, because it represents the destruction of all of our so-called society. So, yeah, Michael, that's all. I just wanted to rant for a second on the differences between the double-headed phoenix and the double-headed eagle, because it's a Freemasonic burden that's been put on us. Do we really understand it? Well, no, not until we study it. Then maybe we get a little bit, but, you know, we're not going to get everything, are we?
Mm. Yeah, in Isaiah 46, verse 11, it's been said that, quote, calling a ravenous bird from the east, the man that excused my counsel from a far country, ye, I have spoken it, I will also bring it to pass, I have proposed it, I will also do it. The problem with the bird is, you see, that there is no reincarnation. Reincarnation is a pagan concept. So also by that, in the Queen logo, we know that it must be some kind of a pagan religion they are promoting, because otherwise, why do they display a phoenix? And in Greek, ring a bell, Herodot tells about the myth of the old Egyptian scriptures who do not back that. So it's Herodot on his own speaking about the myth that there is a holy, so-called holy bird called the phoenix, and it's coming down from Arabia and brings the remains of his fathers wrapped in myrrh in the temple of Helios, which is a sun god, which is Apollo. Helios is a Greek word for Apollo, for Roman Apollo, buried there. And you see that has something to do with the corpse. Yeah, with the corpse of his father wrapped around the mirror, he's coming, flown by to the temple of the sun god. So you see the sun god and the corpse. You see, of course, you're just in Babylon. It's not Arabia. It's not Egypt. It's not Greece. It's Babylon. Right. In the origin.
Sure.
Yeah.
And anything coming out of Egypt, as far as tradition or as far as, you know, these mythical things, is really be careful with that, right, Michael? It's
the level of deception is the level of deception, Brad. You see, it's Wikipedia source in Germany, for example.
Sure.
Yeah? Quoting that, in the late antique, the phoenix was the symbol of infinity. Yeah. You will not surely die. The symbol of you will not surely die, because he had the ability to regenerate if he was wounded by his enemies. And for the Christian people, he was the symbol of resurrection. I'm quoting Wikipedia. It's not, of course, it's totally unbiblical. But you see, you have to be aware that Wikipedia is blatantly putting out some, for the Christians, it's a symbol of resurrection, yeah, which is totally untrue.
Oh boy!
The phoenix never was it.
Yeah, well, which Christians, Michael? Can we say which Christians and be more specific?
Yeah, of course. But actually,
I would say
the
Roman Christians that have no idea of how they've been duped by their hierarchy, I would say that fits the bill well there.
Yeah, but you see that even in the Vulgata, a phoenix has not been mentioned as far as I know.
No, that's true. Yeah.
Yeah. So you see that, where does that claim come from?
Good question.
Yeah. And it's really an actual, it's a thing which we are talking about the year 2014, when in the Eurovision Song Contest, where all the European countries together with Israel, which is very strange because Israel does not belong in any way to the European Union, but can take part in the European Song Contest, where every country has a delegation of a band or a singer and has one song, and then it will be counted which song of all the European nations will be the best, and you send the winner of the European Song Contest making millions and millions of money. So this is a big contest here over in Europe. Yeah, and the winner of that in the year 2014 was the song called Rise Like a Phoenix. Yeah, rise like a phoenix out of the ashes, seeking rather than vengeance, retribution, you were warned, once I'm transformed, once I'm reborn, you know, I will rise like a phoenix, but you're my flame. Yeah, you see that, oh, it's about the pagan belief system of the Egyptians. Yeah, but you see, there's just another meaning of that. Yeah, I rise up to the sky, you threw me down, but I'm gonna fly. Oh, remember something.
Oh, wow. That's a really revealing statement, isn't it?
Huh? Yeah, this is not by coincidence or by accident that this was the number one in 2014.
Oh, yuck. Yeah.
And it gets, and of course, it's Isaiah 14:12. Huh? Or if you like Revelation 12:9, when the great dragon was cast down. Yeah, you threw me down, but I'm going to fly. Yeah. Of course, it's about Lucifer being Satan then. Yeah, I rise up to the sky, you threw me down, but I'm going to fly. You threw me down. You is, of course, Elohim, is about the Lord God. Yeah, the Lord God threw him down, but he's going to fly because he's a spirit. He's not a phoenix. A phoenix is a code word for Lucifer. Rise like a phoenix out of the ashes. Everything, every pagan belief system, when something is rising above to the sky, being thrown down by someone, he's transformed. Yeah, you see that Satan also was transformed in an angel of light, huh? Or you see that Satan was in disguise, not in the skies, but in disguise in the Garden of Eden, in the body of a snake. And it's not, you see, it's not so easy because you see that I raised to the sky, you have thrown me down. It's about this. This is a German verse of Isaiah 14:12. Mm-hmm. How are you fallen down to earth? Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah. And this is the artist, Conchita Wurst.
Yeah. Oh, gee, that guy, we've seen
that
him.
That guy, he did not have his shave today.
How pathetic.
Now, you see here, the Eurovision Song Contest, Copenhagen in Denmark, Austrian entry. So it's coming from Austria. And it's just a running joke here that nothing good is coming out of Austria. Especially for Germans, but it has another origin. And you see here that Rise Like a Phoenix, Conchita Wurst is the name of the so-called artist. Yeah, Conchita Wurst. Wurst means meat.
Boy.
Or, yeah, it's something to eat, especially. So, yeah, you see it's about transgender agenda promoting.
Oh, so perverse, you know, it goes
sausage.
Right in.
Sorry, not meat, but sausage. So it's Conchita, yeah. Sausage. Yeah. Oh, but I think you will proceed with Queen.
Queer, you mean? I'm sorry.
While it has been already pointed out in the answer above that the name could mean the monarch, speaking of the Queen Elizabeth herself, gay or a poser, my hypothesis is that the name was chosen for its regal connotation. Mercury, speaking of Freddie Mercury, lead singer, insisted that the name doesn't have any real meaning, but was aware of the things it might mean. But can we really take Mercury's word as face value? The man, who was extremely secretive about many things such as the meaning of his most famous work, Bohemian Rhapsody, his final resting place, or his struggle with AIDS. Freddie was larger than life, and his flamboyance was unparalleled. By his own admission, he didn't want to be a rock star. He wanted to be a, quote, legend. And the biggest legend in most part of the world in those days was Her Majesty the Queen herself. Because he was born in Zanzibar and grew up in India, both of which were former British colonies, speaking of the Commonwealth of Nations later on. But former in the 19th century, for example, British colonies, where the Queen was the most well-known figure. So what better could have made the band more royal than naming it Queen itself? Finally, Freddie, although secretive, has left enough clues, either consciously or unconsciously, to figure out the meaning of the things that he created, be it the real interpretation of Bohemian Rhapsody or the name of the band, and I believe the answer lies in the logo of the band. And I think that Brad also believes that the answer lies in the logo of the band, which is the Phoenix. On the surface, it looks like a beautiful conglomeration of zodiac signs of the band members. But if you dig deep in the way that they are put together, the Q resembles a royal throne in ancient India, accompanied by the king's help on either sides, resembled by the lions, which we have depicted few minutes ago. It can also be argued that the logo resembles the Royal Coat of Arms of the United Kingdom or Canada or Australia. We see that because it's all a part of the United Kingdom. The presence of the crown in the center of the logo further strengthens the argument that the name of the band is an embodiment of regality. Queen is just a personification of being legendary, iconic, regal, that he wanted his band to be, just as he aspired to be a legend, and that's why the name Queen was chosen. He's not an English man. He's not American also. He's coming down from Zanzibar. Yeah? So he's coming from, from really far away. He's not a European. He's not a European guy. Yeah? But he was under the rule of the Queen Elizabeth. Yeah? Okay, so going deeper into the subject now. This is the statue of Freddie Mercury. Famous, not about only his mustache, but famous about as above, so below. And famous about his microphone. Yeah, because legend says that once he broke his microphone, or what is it here?
The stand.
The microphone stand, yes. And so he used that extension, of course, for obvious reasons. Yeah. Very obvious sexual reasons also, if you get what I mean. Yeah. So, but this is a statue. What does the Bible tell us about idols? Yeah, the statue is larger than life.
Yeah.
The statue has been placed in numerous, or not numerous, but on several European cities. And some statues are about 10 or 12 feet high.
Ay, ay, ay.
Yeah? Yeah, and now look at that. Sorry. Mm. Yeah?
Right.
Yeah, people put roses and presents and something like that. Freddie Mercury, huh?
Making offerings to their little altar. Yeah,
yeah. He does not want to be a rock star. He wanted to be a legend.
Oh, yes. There he is. A legend.
There he is. Yeah. And there it is. There it is. Phoenix again.
Oh, boy.
Huh? So if you have royalty depicted in your own logo, that means that you rule.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. Or at least you are the favorite band of the Queen. But otherwise, the name does not make sense, because you see that even if that would be queer, speaking about the homosexuality of Freddie Mercury, why do they display a crown? Yeah, so yeah, he wanted to rule. He wanted to
obviously,
be the king.
Yeah.
Yeah, he wanted to
more
be
involved in that.
Yeah.
Yeah. Interesting.
Okay, so these are the 70s. Yeah. Guy desperately needs a haircut.
Yeah.
Due to the situation out there, it's very, it's not that easy to get a haircut these days. But in the old days, in the 70s, you could go everywhere and even shake people's hands or hug them. So in the old times, many things were even better than 2020.
Oh, yes.
So, sorry, I skipped it. In April 1970, Freddie Mercury teamed up with guitarist Brian May and drummer Roger Taylor to become lead singer of their band, Smile. They were joined by bassist John Deacon, or bass player, in 1971. Despite the reservations of the other members and Trident,
Trident. Yeah. Where does that name come from?
Could that be? Yeah, where could that be? Yeah, Trinity, huh? The band's initial management, Mercury, chose the name Queen for the new band. He later said it was very regal, obviously, and it sounds splendid. It's a strong name, very universal and immediate. Oh, I know that what another thing is very universal means Catholic.
Oh, yeah. Also, Michael, about Trident, there's also the term Tridentine. Are you familiar with that?
Yeah. Yes.
Yeah, that's interesting, too. That has nothing to do with the Trident, but it has everything to do with the Pope, doesn't it?
Mm-hmm.
But people can look up that word for themselves and study it. But in basically, right, Michael, it's just a form of expressing your allegiance to the Roman hierarchy.
Yeah, I just wanted to say that it's just it's pagan belief system.
Sure, of course.
It's a pagan belief system.
Well, and that's the greatest accomplishment of Roman Catholicism is essentially harnessing all of the pagan belief systems on earth into one central system.
Yeah, you see that the Tridentine is also the coat of arms from, or the symbol of, the Maserati cars. It's a weapon, actually, for the god Poseidon.
Absolutely. Yeah. That's right. That's the myth the story behind the trident. Yeah. Interesting.
Yeah, I have not inserted it here because it was just the name of the, what was it, the record company or something here. So the band's initial.
Yeah. Well, there's also, Michael, are you familiar with the Trident studio console?
Mm-hmm.
Those were manufactured, I believe, in Great Britain. Were they? I think they're a British console. The Ooh. Trident consoles.
Oh, that's a good question.
Pretty sure they are. A lot of really good, actually, a lot of very, very professionally made consoles from Great Britain, like Rupert Neve is a very popular, prominent engineer in Great Britain, and makes actually really high quality stuff. But it's very expensive for the connoisseurs out there.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I know that's very expensive, but I think it's English based, but I'm not quite sure.
I would have to look that up,
but
I can too quick here while you're talking.
It's 1967, originally started by Norman and Barry Sheffield in the house studio for the Central Disc label, Trident Studios, etc. Space was a problem. Yeah. Hmm. But anyway, maybe we should continue here. Some people think well, believed the name was just random, had no real meaning, because that's what Freddie claimed on several occasions. Yeah, well, but you see that Freddie claims something new in every occasion. The band didn't have an official name until right before they released their first album.
Okay, I was wrong. I think Trident looks like were originally built for Trident Studios, and Trident Studios was a British recording facility located in London. Yeah, well, okay. Well, maybe they originated in the United States, but technically they were in London. So, okay, so it's partially correct. Okay.
Yeah, you see, but you see that depicting a crown means that you are some kind, that you prefer a wealthy kingdom, a worldly kingdom. Yeah? Okay, I think we can agree on that. Friends close to Freddie have said that the word queen in England at the time means several things, also a homosexual male, a poser, or the monarch herself. It's pretty clear why Freddie chose the name, whether or not he outright admitted it publicly. As you know, there were a lot of secrets Freddie kept to himself right up until his untimely death, namely his HIV status. He was a shy, reserved, and private person and didn't feel he owed an explanation for anything to anyone, and he was right. I don't think that he was right, but we will get to that quite soon. The Freddie on stage was not the Freddie off stage, and I think that now this is not that much interesting. But, of course, he was a very kind, fair, and generous man with his friends and family. Yes, but that's not the average Freddie Mercury that I found. So, anyway, the thing that why it's been called Queen, if you have the logo with the fifth member, the Phoenix on top, and with the crown, I think it's very pretty obvious, because you demand to be a legend. You demand to be praised. You demand to be treated like a king or queen. Sorry. <Yeah. laughs> even if you dress up like a queen, or you dress up not like a male. Yeah. So maybe he did also dress like a queen, but you see, that's just a joke here. Huh? Okay. Freddie Mercury, his original name is Farrokh Bulsara, and it's not also his entire name, because his entire name is Farrokh Pluto Bulsara, if I remember correctly. So, he's got the Pluto in it, and Pluto is a so-called miniature planet, and no, to this day, I think I think he lost the status of being a planet in the meantime, but...
Wow. Yeah, it's interesting, isn't it? How that name just... is, wow, who would come up with a name like that?
And you cannot become a superstar in Europe or America with the name Farrokh Bulsara.
Oh, right. Or Farrokh Pluto Bulsara, right?
Yeah. I think that makes it worse, actually.
Can we say that name's pretty out there, man?
Yeah. Yeah.
Wow.
Yeah, and his nickname in the time at the boy internat or a close school, not a public school, but a close school. Okay, but in the boy school, he got his nickname Freddy.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. Okay, moving on. That's the first album of Queen. Ah. Some kind of resemblance here with the logo, huh? Un día y la carreras. A day at the races.
Hmm.
Yeah. And rumor has it that Freddie has composed the song Crazy Little Thing Called Love in his bath tube. And Thank God It's Christmas is on no album of the band been published, but only on the Queen's Greatest Hit. But yeah, and they didn't want to publish the song Another One Bites the Dust only after Michael Jackson insisted and said that, well, please publish that. And in his passport, the name was Frederick Mercury. This, of course, was his artist's name. His real name is Farrokh Pluto Bulsara. Yeah. And Bohemian Rhapsody is after Do They Know It's Christmas and Candle in the Wind, the most sold, selling, best-selling song in the United Kingdom. Okay. So far, so good. This was about the band name logo of Queen. You can make your own mind up what it actually means, I think. But if we go deeper or closer to Freddie Mercury, we will see what meaning it could have. This is Freddie Mercury in his, in his usual days in the 70s or early 80s.
He got a haircut.
Yes.
Sure looks a lot different, doesn't he?
Yeah. Was born in September 1946 as Farouk Pluto Bulsara in Zanzibar City, Sultanate Zanzibar, and died in 1991 in Kensington, London. A British musician, meaning he had a British passport, and one of the most well-known rock singers of the 70s and 80s. He was one of the founders, composers, and lead singers of the band Queen. Mercury composed world hits like Bohemian Rhapsody or We Are the Champions. And he was raised in India, 1946 to 1963. So his entire youth he spent in India. Yeah, this is his house where he used to live. I think you would not exchange.
Man.
Yeah, it was the first child of the British embassy, a worker for the embassy, Mr. Bumi Bulsara, and his wife, Jer. The family is original from India and belonged to the Parsan. And the Parsan is from Persia, a religious group following the religion of Zoroastrianism.
Oh yes,
yeah. it's a very exotic kind of a religion. Not many people are following that religion, and these are the followers of the god called Ahura Mazda. And please, it's no coincidence. It's about the car manufacturer Mazda. Also, the Japanese car manufacturer Mazda has named their company according to the god of Zoroastrianism from Persia. If you didn't know that, maybe. It originated between 1800 or to 600 before Christ. This is a special religion which has also a god and an evil demon called Ahriman. And you see, this is just Ahura Mazda is the god and it's a symbol of light and fire. Oh, what about the phoenix from the ashes? And it's about flying and it's a good spirit. And the name Fahawa means also the highest elect chosen good spirit who's flying. Yeah, this is
interesting you bring this up, because do you remember, Michael, when you and I and Jörg Lissmann were doing some readings from that little book, The Divine Program of the World's History, when we came across that research that Jörg did in the Behistun inscription from the Wikipedia page?
Yeah.
Oh, yeah, that's really revealing.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, and I mean, Zoroastrianism, huh? Mm-hmm. That has a lot to do with the bigger picture, you know? This history we were never told about. And this Behistun inscription is in Iran, I believe.
Yes, Iran is a modern name for Persia, actually. That's where the religion of Zoroastrianism. Ah, please.
Mm-hmm. The origin of Zoroastrian. Yeah. Ah, that is a tough one to pronounce. I have a hard time too. I don't want to butcher it.
And we're not making fun of the religion. We're just having issues with the correct spelling of the word. Yeah.
Yeah, that's right.
Yeah, and this is the symbol of the display of the human soul before the birth and after death. And you see that's just about something with the bird with wings, which can fly, or who can fly. Yeah? Also a ring here. It's very interesting. Yeah? And you see that's the same about Mazda.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah? Yeah, and it's the Mazda Motor Corporation. Yeah. The name is according to Ahura Mazda, the highest Zoroastrian god of wisdom and knowledge. Yeah. So even a Japanese car manufacturer uses the name of the Zoroastrian god. And there are archangels. Yeah. And also, maybe you know Friedrich Nietzsche, a very well-known German philosopher who got mad at the end of his days, insulting God. There is no God. God is death. And one of his famous quotes. And he was looking for the Übermensch. And superhuman, and there's also a very famous tune coming from Stanley Kubrick, 2001, an instrumental song with trumpets called Thus Spoke Zarathustra. Yeah? And this is also related to Zoroastrianism. So there are many more things Nietzsche, 2001, Mazda, then it would appear at first glance. So at Zarathustra, the ruler of wisdom has also six powers of light, and he's the seventh one. So he's the god. He's the head of gods. Zarathustra. And there are many well-known Zoroastrian followers, like the husband of Indira Gandhi, coming out of India, of course, prime minister, former prime minister, and here Freddie Mercury, Farouk Pluto, is he missing? Farouk Pluto Plusara, singer of the rock band Queen. So I will not get into Zoroastrianism because it's very hard for me to explain that in English. So, but you see that he's a Zoroastrian on the outside, okay? Because he was raised that way and he spent his entire youth and his childhood in India. And his parents also were Zoroastrianism believers. And he got the nickname Freddy then. In the English-speaking St. Peter's School, in Bombay. Now this is India, nevertheless.
I can't help it, Michael. On that previous page, I just glanced and I saw the name Rudolf Steiner.
Yes, you're right. Yeah.
And I just want to share a little something about that because I had an experience working for someone that was an avid student of Rudolf Steiner. And I didn't really understand at all anything in this realm when I was in my 30s and early 40s till I was revealed what that meanings, those esoteric meanings are. It has to do with yeah, he was a, what would you just say, a Freemason, right? Or a cultist or whatever.
So yeah, you see, it's been displayed here, or it's been said here in German, that Zoroastrianism also has influenced on the anthroposophy, the teaching of Rudolf Steiner. Yeah, gotcha. but you see that Rudolf Steiner is also Luciferian because he has published a magazine called Lucifer Gnosis and is highly aficionated affiliated with Helena Petrova Blavatsky and all these other people.
Exactly. So it's all just another pagan root. When you get down to it, it's all stemming from paganism and the promotion of Lucifer as divine, which is completely opposite, completely adversarial of Jesus Christ.
Yes, and you see that Rudolf Steiner has a couple of highly praised schools here.
Absolutely, yeah. The Waldorf schools, yeah.
Yes, correct, yeah. No. He's the founder of Anthroposophy, spiritual worldview. You see that it also relates, it mostly relates to Gnosis and Blavatsky. And of course, he's also been involved with many more, many prominent people you would not like to meet.
No, we can move on. I just wanted to mention it because that sticks out. Whenever I see that name, I think, oh boy.
That's correct. Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Knee jerk reaction, you know.
Yeah. Okay. Let's move on. So, Farouk comes from Persia, nowadays called Iran. Yeah, Farouk is a boy's name that originated there. And his nickname now is Freddy, which is the short form of Frederick. What does Frederick mean? That's his nickname. Huh? It's not his original name. This name has been given to him by his so-called fellows at the school. And I used to look up the word. I said before, private school. He was schooled in a private school, taught in a private school. It's a boarding school. That's what I looked for. Yeah, it's called. It's a mixing of the word. Frederick actually means peace, safety, might, power, rulership. Mm-hmm. Yeah. So it's really interesting. He got the name Freddy. Yeah. And the director of the boarding school, he just realized his musical talent and proposed to his parents that he should have piano lessons. And he was singing in the choir, and he has been introduced to the band The Hectics at the age of 12. Yeah. The Hectics.
The Hectics. That's
I don't have the time. The Hectics, consisting of 5 cats. Just an inside joke. Yeah.
Oh, sure.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. So then there was a revolution against the Sultan of Zanzibar, and they fled with their 70-year-old son, Freddie Mercury, obviously, or Farouk, Pluto, etc., and his sister, Kashmira, to London. So he was, if you like to say it that way, he was a refugee, yeah, and he then got to the Isoward Polytechnicum, and he was being granted with the A-level certificate, and he was an art student at the Ealing College of Art and with a diploma, and he has made several drawings from his idols, Jimi Hendrix, Rock Hudson. Rock Hudson, you know, huh? HIV and homosexual also, Paul McCartney and Cliff Richard.
Oh,
none of them is clean.
None of them. Right.
Yeah. Also, he developed late fashionable men's clothing. I think that's a very strange kind of profession if you create men's fashion as a male. But you see that, that's Freddie Mercury, huh?
Yeah.
And this, everything else here is not that interesting. He's got making his money, and he liked to listen to and play Jailhouse Rock from Elvis Presley. But you see that now it's very interesting because we know about the origin of his surname Freddie, but where does Mercury come from? Because his artist name is Freddie Mercury, right?
Right.
So the English word Mercury has several meanings, like Mercury, the next planet of our so-called solar system, with the chemical element quicksilver and the god Mercury of the Roman mythology, which had the special position of being an angel of the gods. A messenger. And Brian May said, there's a clue in the Freddie Mercury song called My Fairy King from the first album Queen. And in one line, it's called Mother Mercury, is its quote, Mother Mercury, look what they've done to me. It's like Amanda Lear said, Mother, look what they've done to me. Look what they've done to me. Mother Mercury, look what they've done to me. I cannot run, I cannot hide. Yeah, so if he's speaking to Mother Mercury, he must be Mr. Mercury, huh? So that's, backed that up and he said, yes, and from now on, I'll be Freddie Mercury. Yeah, but Mercury is also Quicksilver, which is, it's called Quicksilver. And actually, it's very dangerous because it's poison.
And this is so, Michael, just to get back, I'm a little slow here this morning. I just want to make sure we get this right. Now, it was Amanda Lear that inspired him to take the name?
Just a so-called coincidence, because the line, look what they've done to me, appears also at Amanda Lear. And Amanda Lear started out as a man.
Right.
And then was a transvestite called Peggy Doslow. And there are several biographies of transsexual people who confirmed that Peggy Doslow and Amanda Lear is the same person. But he had a surgery at the beginning of the 1960s in Africa, I think, if I remember correctly, in Morocco. And after that, she got to be the muse of Salvador Dali, which was a very ill man. Yeah? Salvador Dali, I have several quotes of him having sex orgies. And he's a very special guy. And he made very sick art also. I can back that because I know that where he's got his inspiration from.
Mm-hmm. Yeah?
But you see that it's just here a so-called coincidence for the German followers of this of the script and of the series that they know that it's about it's the same thing is repeating the same line is repeated here. Look what they've done to me. So who's they? Yeah, he said Mother Mercury. Look what they've done to me, but it's not explained who they are. I cannot run. I cannot hide. So. Okay, we can go into the song text. But you see that's the official explanation where the name Mercury actually comes from. But you see, at the same time, Mercury is also the Roman name of the messenger of the gods. And can you imagine being a legend, serving his gods, his Zoroastrian gods, as being a messenger? Well, he's putting out messages, actually. He's putting out messages when he's doing his songs.
I'm sorry, Michael. It's just not clear to me where that quote comes from, where he says, okay, from now on, I'll be called Freddie Mercury.
Okay, we go. No, it's no problem here. You see that.
That's where I'm not connecting. It's just not.
Okay. No problem.
Yeah. I just want to know.
it's just your German script. You see.
Yes. Exactly.
Okay. The English word Mercury has several. Sorry.
This is the hard part for me.
No. The English word Mercury has several meanings, like Mercury, the next planet of our so-called solar system, and the chemical element of Quicksilver, and the god Mercury of the Roman mythology, who had the special position of being a messenger to the gods. According to his queen fellow, Brian May, There is a reference to a Freddie Mercury song called My Fairy King from the first album Queen. And in this song, there is one verse called Mother, quote, Mother Mercury, look what they've done to me. Yeah. I cannot run, I cannot hide. And after this song has been recorded, Freddie Bulsara has been asked if Mother Mercury is his own mother, and he repeated and answered yes, and from now on, I will be Freddie Mercury.
I get it. Okay. Thank you.
But you see, Mercury actually is the name of a chemical element and of a Roman god.
Mm.
And that makes it now special, very special, because it has several meanings. Yeah. And I'm at this moment looking upon on my smartphone here to the lyrics of the song here, what is supposed to be the origin of his being Freddie Mr. Mercury. And this is not easy, speaking at the same time, translating in your head and looking down at a smartphone.
Oh, no, it's not.
Yeah. And it's about dragons flying like sparrows through the air. It's here. In this song text. Yeah?
Wow.
Yeah. To take away the power from the magic hand.
Mm. Man.
And now the connection here. Now it counts again. Yeah. And Mother Mercury, look what they've done to me. Yes, I can back that up. It's actually in the song text. And in the song text, it speaks out also about the Son of Heaven set me free and let me go. Fire burning in hell with the city of screaming pain. The take away the power from the magic hand. My fairy king can do right and nothing wrong. And dragons fly like sparrows through the air. I think you get the picture. Mm. But look what they've done to me. Mother Mercury is actually in the last parts of the song. So, shall we believe Freddie Mercury? But you see that in the first question which arises would be, why did he get to Mercury at all in the song text? Because you see that Mercury is not the usual name.
There we go. That's the deep question.
Now, where did he get his inspiration?
Yes, yes. Well, obviously he's taken the name Mercury now, so it actually means quite a bit, doesn't it?
Yeah. Yeah. And remember that this band is used to be called Queen. So it's something to do with royalty.
Yes, of course.
Yeah, and so out of the possibilities here with Mother Mercury, where in the song text itself it speaks about gods and dragons, and Mercury being a poisonous chemical element, which is also related to alchemy, which is witchcraft. And this is the alchemy symbol, which is ridiculous because it's also the symbol of the Mercury in the astrology, so at the planet. Yeah, so it's Mercury also. It's the Roman goddess Mercury also. Yeah. So you see that it's not in any way, it's not positive. Huh? It's either poison or... this Mercury is the same as in Greek, the Hermes. Yeah, it's the same. And the Romans and the alchemists, they say they call it Mercury. It's the same as Hermes. Hermes. Yeah. And there's also a DJ called Quicksilver for that reason. Yeah. So in Quicksilver has been used in the alchemy to improve metals. Yeah, so from copper should evolve silver. And you see the alchemy is, of course, something else. And you see, now you look at that. The unicorn symbolized the mercury or the quicksilver. Ah, interesting, huh? The unicorn, remember the coat of arms of the United Kingdom. The unicorn symbolized the quicksilver. Mm-hmm. And also, this is the ingredient of these things. Yeah, this is quicksilver here.
Yeah.
This is poisonous. Poisonous is right, no? Poisonous?
Yeah, that's correct.
Poisonous. Mm-hmm. Okay.
So it's in a vacuum. Isn't that what makes the thermometer work?
Yes. Yeah. And that's what makes it dangerous at the same time.
Right. Right. So there's maybe a tiny amount of oxygen in there. And mm-hmm. then the fluctuations in temperature change the rise and fall of the mercury.
Mm-hmm. Has been used also here in so-called black light lights, black light fuses. Mm-hmm. And also quicksilver is being used for some components of fixing a teeth. But as it is poisonous, I would not recommend to use it anymore. Yeah. See, that's quite a big and now it goes. I hope it's an interesting session, but now it gets really worse. Beyond or beneath, down under the Maya temple pyramid of the Quetzalcoatl, that's the snake. Mexican archaeologists have found fluid quicksilver. They suppose that it's a ritual thing, a ritual display of the river of the underworld, which is the same as in the Greek, the river Styx, which is the river of death. The river you have to cross when you are going on your last journey. Don't pay the ferryman. Remember Peter Gabriel's script? Don't pay the ferryman.
Yes.
Yeah. To the other side, which is, of course, what it is. The Hades, or of course, the side where the death bodies are after life. Yeah, and so quicksilver.
Right, so the opposite of that would be, or not the opposite, but a different way of putting it would be, okay, you're going to rise up and go to heaven, or you're going to fall beneath and go to hell.
Yeah, so, of course. But right. You see that if you believe in these mystic, in these fairy tales, in the other side, and in the river Styx, and all these pagan belief systems, then it's quite obvious you will not reach heaven of the Lord God, because you're not you're not a member of his belief system. Of course, you do not believe in Jesus Christ anyway.
Right, and nor are you in line with. Yeah,
and quicksilver, it's mercury. Yeah, is a poisonous heavy metal. Heavy metal? Ring a bell. Ring a bell. Yeah, ring a bell.
Yeah, big huge gong.
Heavy metal is also it's also the name of a very aggressive music genre, huh?
Hey, you know, and it's also the tendency of so-called Iron Kingdom too, isn't it?
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
The Roman Kingdom.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Heavy
that's
metal.
That's correct. Yeah.
Okay.
Oh, why are the pyramids of Gizeh are displayed here from Pink Floyd, Dark Side of the Moon? By the way, you know that Lilith, you see this has been connected to Oz, is also depicted as the dark goddess for the dark moon. I don't know if I have cited that or quoted that in the Pink Floyd scripts, but you see that here Alan Parsons uses Egyptian symbols in the eye of the sky. Or Kiss Vinnie Vincent uses the Egyptian Ankh. And Queen uses the phoenix. Oh, sorry. Okay, Egypt. Pyramids, Pink Floyd. Egypt, Eye of Horus, Alan Parsons Project. Egypt, symbol of the Ankh, Kiss. Egypt, Phoenix, Queen. Coincidence? You see, this is not only the symbol of alchemy, but also the symbol of the planet Mercury. It's the smallest and the nearest to the sun. That's why it's extremely hot and extremely cold, because the side which is supposed to be away from the sun is about minus 170 degrees. This is Celsius. I'm sorry, I have not calculated it what it is in Fahrenheit, but you see the difference here of about 600 degrees Celsius. I think that's means quite a lot. So you cannot live there. Yeah. And this is Mercury Games. Yeah? Mercury, you see, it's a boot with a wing. Yeah? Mercury is supposed the messenger of the gods. Okay? So these are the Mercury Games. Because this is a foot or a boot of the Roman god Mercury, which has to fly because he's a messenger for the gods. He has to fly from the earth to the sky and from the sky to the earth and from the god to another god and what else? Yeah? This is just German. You won't get that. So this is in German. This is one of the most famous and well-known manufacturer of these machines, these game machines, gaming Germany. Yeah, it's also Merkur, which is the German word for Mercury. Yeah, it's all about game, because Mercury also is the trader and betrayer. Quite another mean. Yeah. Oh, look here. Huh? Mercury games, Mercury magic. Magic is sorcery, is witchcraft. Huh? It's actually evil. And Hermes is also the Greek name of the Roman Mercury. And in the Greek mythology, it's the god of the traffic, of the merchants, and of the shepherds, and the god of the thieves, of the speaking art, or the rhetoric, the gymnastic, and magi, or magic. And as the messenger of gods, he proclaims the rules of Zeus, which is the head of the gods in the Greek, and he leads the souls of the deceased in the Hades, which is the underworld or the hell. Because the Greek word for hell is actually Hades. It's actually in the Bible, also in the King James Bible. If you look upon the ESORT software, it will tell you that the name for hell is the Greek Hades. And he's one of the 12 big Olympic gods. That's what they are being praised. These are being praised at the Olympic Games, actually, huh? With the five rings. Five, huh? Five rings, symbol for the Olympic Games. I have not inserted it here. I'm really ashamed now. But the Roman equivalent to Hermes is the god Mercurius. Yeah, and that relates to Latin mercies, which are merchants. Yeah, and this also is similar to the Egyptian god thought of the Egyptian mythology. That's also in Egyptian the god of magic. And as Hermes Trismegistos, the three big Hermes, he's actually also related to philosophy, astrology, magic, and alchemy. Yeah, it's the same here in every kind of human history. Be it Greek, be it Persian, be it Egyptian, be it Roman, it's everything the same. Just the name changes, but not the game. The game is also the same, to distract you from the Bible, to have a numeral, to have a various amount of gods. Yeah, we just have one Lord God. Yeah, but they do not. Yeah, but you see that Mercury has not, or Hermes, yeah, this is a symbol for a German parcel service, Hermes. Yeah, you see, this is a depicted wing here, which you saw at the foot of the Mercury Games. Yeah, who are being famous for being a very prominent dispatcher of goods, yeah, shipping company. Yeah, and this is him. Yeah, you see here his flute. You see his horn. You see his wings. You see the wings. Yeah, this is Hermes, Mercury, whatever you might imagine. Yeah.
Huh, and look at that hat. It looks like eyes of an eagle, maybe, on the top, with the beak, maybe.
Or yeah, is it just now, a bird? Imagine if Freddie Mercury had not only Miss Mercury or Mother Mercury in his mind, but he's speaking about the Mercury of the gods, being a messenger for the gods. because you see that he wanted to be royal, he wanted to be a legend. He wanted to be a top. He wanted not to, he did not want to be a measly human. He didn't want to become a legend. And you see that Mercury also is related to music. You see, this is a musical instrument as well as that. Okay, this is much more for speech maybe, but it's also like a short trumpet.
Right.
Yeah, and he is related, the Mercury is related to art. So that was just about the name of Freddie Mercury. See, he wanted to become a legend. I think that he was just referring to the god Mercury or Mercur or what else. I think that because he's in the musical business, and Mercurius or Mercur, you see that he's also related to music, to arts. Yeah, he was the messenger of arts. Yeah. Okay, let's move on. We will have so much more evidence about that later on. In the early 1970s, Mercury lived together with the Mary Austin. Both has a flat in the London West Kensington, and he was the official partner, female partner of Mercury, and she witnessed the breakthrough of Queen. And he has also published a single in 1973 under his artificial name Larry Lyrics. In October 1975, they have published a single called Bohemian Rhapsody, which was 9 weeks in a row number one in the British charts and was the first number one hit of Queen. Been sold more than 5 million times, 2 platinum, 3 golden records, and he has a very strange text which we come across later on. And personal assistant Peter Freestone tells his thesis that Mercury in Bohemian Rhapsody would describe his coming out as a homosexual guy. Now that's his official explanation. Okay. Then in Mercury has several relationships to men, but never publicly announced his homosexuality. In 1975-1976, he was separated with Mary Austin because he outed himself and as told her the truth. But they remained friends until his untimely death in 1971. So she was his so-called best friend.
Okay? Oh, 1991 looks like, right?
What did I say?
The death in 1991, was it?
Yes.
Okay. You said 71, but no big deal.
Oh, sorry. Yeah, it's 1991. Yeah, okay.
Yeah.
Yeah. From 1979 to 1985, he chose Munich at his main location, main living.
So how old was Freddie Mercury when he died? No, let's see. He was born...
He died in 1991. He was born 1946,
was it or something?
I think it was 1946, yeah.
I think I remember that, yeah. So 46 and 91. Yeah, he wasn't that old.
No, he wasn't that old. He 45 just
45 years old?
45, yes.
Boy, that's not old, man.
No, he wanted to become a legend, yeah. He wants to become
a
legend.
That's
you see,
right.
all these legend has to die, because legend actually means that you have been you being talked over. People talk about you, and therefore to be a legend, usually you have to die first. Yeah. So you see that either way you look upon that, all these legends don't get old. Think about Elvis Presley.
Yeah.
Think about Jimi Hendrix. His idol was Jimi Hendrix. Compared with Jimi Hendrix, who has officially told that he has been confronted with demons. Mm-hmm. Yeah. But you see that just maybe a rumor, but I have written it several times, but Jimi Hendrix just got 28.
Mm-hmm.
Or compare that to James Dean.
Oh, that is really young to die.
Yeah, compare that to James Dean.
Mm,
a very lonely, misunderstood man died at the age of 24.
Oh, James Dean, yeah.
Yeah.
I don't know hardly anything about James Dean.
Oh, no. I did. I have several dozens of pages about him already.
Another so-called legend, yeah.
It was a very, very, very lonely and depressed man for several reasons. Yeah. Sorry, but you see that they are being claimed, they've been have a legend, but you see that during their lifespan, they had a very glamorous life, of course, but you see that, isn't that worth it?
No.
None of these legends.
I don't know.
Look after the facade of every legend, but you will see that these people have to
they have to reap what they've been sown, or what they've sown. Reap what they've sown.
What they haven't got in their youth, or haven't got love or something else in their youth, they have to compensate that later on stage. Actually, these are very poor people.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, especially when you talk about James Dean. That's so obvious that he was very, very depressed, young man. Yeah, okay. But you see, he chose Munich as his main residence. And 1983, he was being invited, or he come across the actress Barbara Valentin, which is a very infamous person in Germany. He was moving into a flat, and he was in the Munich homosexual scene in the so-called Glockenbach Viertel very present. And in the liner notes of his solo album, Mr. Bad Guy, he thanks her for, you see that here, for Big Peep 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 and Misconduct. Yeah, and this was his girlfriend in later on. Yeah. And she was a sex bomb and something else. And she was actually being an actress and some kind of a singer. And what I mentioned here is a German film of the 1970s, 1973, which most or almost all of the American and English audience will not know. It's called Welt am Draht, or World on Wire. Yeah. So if you pick up a telephone, you got someone on the wire. What's it in American English?
On the line. Yeah.
On the line. Yeah. Okay. So World on the Line. Yeah. And World on the Line is a television series from the world famous German director Rainer Werner Fassbinder, or at least in Europe very known, on the basis of the science fiction novel Simulacron 3. And no one will know that movie. Really, no one will know that movie. But if I tell you what this movie is about, then you will see that, oh my, 1973 already. Yes, 1973 already. It's a predecessor of The Matrix.
Oh, really?
Yeah. It's about 1973 in Germany, running this movie about a supercomputer called Simulacron 1, so like simulation, which can and is able to simulate a small town. The simulation runs 24/7. And this town is only populated by so-called identity units who are leading almost the same life as the usual living people and have a conscience. besides one only contact unit, no one knows about simulated people, that their world is a simulation or a simulacrum. And this is 26 years before The Matrix in 1999. That's something, huh?
Yeah.
That's an old German movie. And this is a still from the movie. And look at that symbol here.
That's exactly what I was going to say.
Yeah. Look at that symbol.
Why is that in there? Yeah, gee.
Yeah,
why?
That's a symbol actually of the company running the simulation. So it's about a pyramid with an eye-like shape inside. And so nothing new under the sun.
No.
Nothing new. Nothing new. Yeah. And also Mrs. Barbara Valentin, who was affiliated with Freddie Mercury, at least they lived together. He lived in her flat. And there she had several drug problems. And she has also short-term relationship with Mr. Rolf Eden, which is known as running infamous nightclub. You would call it some kind of a pimp or something like that. Some kind of, I'm not judging or saying, but it's hard for me to pronounce it, but he's known as a playboy. He's known that he's like a German version of Hugh Hefner, huh? Something like that. Okay. So, and she was living together with Freddie Mercury of Queen. She always got a part in the video of It's a Hard Life. And after the death of Freddie Mercury in 1991, she was engaging herself in the AIDS support help. That's about Barbara Valentin so far. Yeah? This is a picture of Barbara Valentin. Yeah, and this is, of course, Mr. Mercury. This time not shaved. Well, yeah. Okay, you see this two of them not together. Yeah. And Mr. Mercury, so speaking of Freddie, has of this at this time also a luxury apartment been rented and was engaged with the Munich Mr. Winnie Kirchberger. He's running some kind of a nightclub and running some kind of a restaurant or something like that. And he has an intensive partnership. And Freddie presented him an auto and a car, sorry, and an apartment. And Mr. Kirchberger died in the year 1993, officially from AIDS.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, you see. I know that's not the best picture here, but at least you see that I'm not telling anything out of the blue. Okay. And this is where Romans 13:13 came into play. And I think that maybe this is a good time that you could insert or read Romans 13:13.
Sure, Michael. Just let me get it up here quick and I will read it. Romans 13:13 is, let us walk honestly as in the day, not rioting in drunkenness, not in chambering and wantonness, not in strife and envying.
Mm-hmm. And I'm also quoted here 1 Corinthians 6:18.
1 Corinthians 6:18. Which is, flee fornication. Every sin that a man doeth is without the body, but he that committeth fornication sinneth against his own body.
Mm-hmm. And 1 Corinthians 7:2.
All right. 1 Corinthians 7:2 reads, Nevertheless, to avoid fornication, let every man have his own wife, and let every woman have her own husband.
And 2 Corinthians 12:21.
2 Corinthians 12:21. And lest, when I come again, my God will humble me among you, and that I shall bewail many which have sinned already, and have not repented of their uncleanliness, and fornication, and lasciviousness which they have committed.
Mm-hmm. And Galatians 5:19.
Galatians 5:19 reads. Here we go, 19. Now the works of the flesh are manifest, which are these: adultery, fornication, uncleanliness, and lasciviousness.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
And it continues, too, to say idolatry, witchcraft, hatred, variance, emulations, wrath, strife, seditions, heresies, envying, murders, drunkenness, revelings, and such the like.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, that's quite a load there.
Yeah, you see that
but adultery, that was, fornication is on the very top, yes.
Mm. Yeah, that's actually the life of Freddie Mercury.
Yes.
Yeah?
Yes, true.
That's actually the life of Mercury. And you see that 1983, and I think we shall close it down on that session here today, but you see that 1983, he began on his solo album called Mr. Bad Guy.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. He produced it together with Mr. Reinhold Mack. Yeah, Mack, who has been worked as a producer for several Queen records. And you know that I think that this is also the same Mack for the Electric Light Orchestra, because Electric Light Orchestra used a producer called Mack. And I'm quite sure that it's the same. So the Queen and Electric Light Orchestra both were produced in Munich.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. And so then he had a relationship to Jim Hutton and was going back to London, 1985 to 1989. And he had a relationship with Mr. Jim Hutton, who was also HIV positive and died 2010 on lung cancer. Yeah, so that you see that everybody around Mr. Freddie Mercury, there are several guys who were also being HIV positive tested. I'm not going into that subject now, but you see that the thing is that he was. We will go into that, but I think we should close it down here because he has tried out almost everything. Almost everything. I'm not judging Mr. Freddie Mercury. He's got a great voice. He's got a talent, of course. But you see that there are some strange things going on here in Queen. And we are just at the beginning of a study of Queen, where Freddie Mercury comes from, where the name and the meaning of Queen derived from, and etc., etc. And this is just the beginning of Queen. This is not a complete study up to now. So if you think that something is missing, just please wait for the next sessions to come. Because you see that I cannot speak hours and hours and hours about the relationship. This is just to give you the picture that the life of Freddie Mercury was not the life that we as Christians would like to lead. Yeah, he had no children. He had not a normal love life. He has no fiancé. He had no wife. He had no this. He had no retreat. He was just busy in the nightlife, going around, moving around, being together with male and female and everything. You see, this is not a healthy life. He just got 45 years old. 45 years old. And I don't think that someone out there who also can admire the works and the sound of the, and the voice of Mr. Freddie Mercury would like to change his place or position to become a world famous singer and a world legend and just getting 45 years old, getting very sick at the end. I don't think that you would like to change your life with the life of Mr. Freddie Mercury. And yeah, thank you for listening to this beginning of the Queen studies. I hope you would have gained some interesting facts. And I would leave it now for my beloved brother Brett to close it down. Please read your Bible.
Yeah, Michael, you know, I couldn't help it when you were asking me over all the artists, you know, which should we do next to continue our journey into the Satanic Media Agenda Exposed, because my older brother, when I was growing up, would listen to this artist a lot. And, you know, it was kind of a joke to my brother. He didn't really, I don't think he really likes the music that much. It's more what Freddie Mercury stood for and what he you know, it was just kind of a sarcasm, a kind of a joke, in a strange way. And yeah, it's really a strange kind of music, actually, because, you know, he has actually a lovely voice. He really does. But the way he uses it, it's kind of like Jimi Hendrix. You listen to Jimi Hendrix and the guitar, the wailing guitar of Jimi Hendrix is unmatched. But listen to those lyrics. What's the meaning of the lyrics? Such profound, what can we say, explicit sexuality really is perverse, and it really is damaging. Yeah, it's led a lot of people to a lifestyle that goes far, far off the path to a repentant believer. So, Michael, thank you for putting the time into translating this work into English in real time, which is not that easy to do, by the way. It requires a lot of thought. And we kindly ask our listeners to humbly accept mistakes of perhaps making a couple errors here and there because of the differences in our language. But I think, Michael, we, as both an American here and European there, we both have to come together to take a look at this quote-unquote Western society we live in, because actually a lot of the things that happen in America reflect onto Europe, and likewise a lot of things in Europe reflect back on America. And there's quite a bit of confusion as far as I'm concerned, and it's good to kind of clear this up a little bit, at least in my mind. I'm not sure about our listeners, but I would hope that many of those out there that are listening would understand that we are just trying to come to grips with what we've witnessed in our lives, in our young lives, this world, this crazy world we live in. It just doesn't stop. It doesn't slow down to explain to us. Of course, they want to keep us going in the direction that they put forth. And that's why the liar will always come first. And these people make all kinds of money off the lies. And what do? They become idolaters and they worship themselves and the work of their own hands. Just like it says in the Bible, we're not to do these things. These things do not they do not lead us to eternal life. They lead us into this drunken revelry. And that's what we see in the industry. That's what we see in the world. And it keeps getting promoted as something quote unquote glorious when it has nothing at all to be with, you know, what true glory and true honor is about. So again, looking forward to continuing into the journey with the disturbing truth about the band Queen of, I think it was the late 70s, right, Michael? Early 80s, the Queen, or mid 80s maybe, that Queen had risen to the top of its success, and to see Freddie Mercury pass away at 45 years old is very sad, but it also reflects upon the type of seeds that he had sown without coming to the knowledge of truth and repentance, which all of us potentially can do. But when you are so involved, like many in the series that Michael has put together, these artists just get so tied up in the world, they can't see the spiritual truth anymore because they've left that path and they've joined hands with the harlot in Rome, and they've taken the silver. They've taken that reprobate silver that was tempted by Satan. Satan just tempts everybody to take that silver, and those that do will pay the price. And one way or another, whether it comes right away or it comes later, it eventually will lead to death, right? Because it says over and over in the Bible that the wages of sin is death. Just that simple. So again, thanks for listening. Thanks for joining us. Looking forward to the comments. Please keep them in line. If you have anything, what should we say? Insulting, personal attacks, things like that, they all get deleted instantly the moment Michael or I see them. They're gone. So don't even bother putting them in there. And you can just go elsewhere on the YouTube. There's plenty of videos for you out there. And these are videos for people considering, you know, what, how deep does this really go? What do these Bible believers have to say about, you know, what's going on with the satanic media agenda? Because I believe a lot of people that are stuck with mysticism and stuck with the common teachings we grow up with in this world, in this day and age, they are trying to understand what the Bible's about, and really you have to read it for yourself. And ultimately we hope that you will be saved and you will realize and you will have some kind of Holy Spirit conviction that will come upon you sometime in your life, maybe not now, maybe later. And we are hoping that is the case, and we want to see as many souls be saved as possible, not for our glory or our benefit, but for our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. And on that note, we'll see you next time. God bless and bye-bye, and don't forget to read your King James Bible. Maranatha. We'll be right back.